Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop.
Matt's Basement Workshop is proudly sponsored by Highland Woodworking, your dependable online resource for woodworking tools, books, and supplies. With quick delivery to all 50 states, Highland is home with the legendary wood slicer bandsaw resawing blade. Visit them today at highlandwoodworking.com. Now, when we're working with plywood, of course, we have various options for how we want to hide the plies, at least if you decide you want to hide the plies. Using plywood and having the plies exposed, it is another option in the design process, but what we decided is we wanted to use some solid wood edging versus using a veneer or leaving the plies exposed. So what I'm doing right now is I am measuring the vertical portions for the base of the bookcase, and I'm going to use relative dimension here. So what you see me doing is I already have the vertical pieces ripped to the width that I want, and then I'm going to use them to get the actual length that I need. So I just put them right up to the base, and I mark with a very sharp pencil or a marking knife where I need to cut them off. So that's what I did first. Now I've ganged them all together, and I've lined up those marks so that I can make just one cut on all three pieces simultaneously. So you saw me using the square there. I'm going to go ahead and grab my carcass saw. I've clamped the three pieces together so that, again, the mark that I just made is all lined up, and I can gang it and get it out of the way all at once. I'm applying a little wax to the plate of the saw just to help it move a little bit easier. This is a very common technique. I use it with my hand planes. I use it with my saws. Like I said, it's a rather old technique. Now, the one thing I'm doing here is at this point, I didn't have my surface vise from Veritas, so I'm using my bench dogs to help me kind of wedge the piece in place, because when we're using a Western style saw, we're pushing forward, so by having it wedged the way it is, I'm using the forward momentum to help keep it in position. Now, unfortunately, I hate to say, but my sawing technique right here needs to be a little improved. I should know way better than this, but didn't take very long at all. I'm just going to go ahead and kind of move it forward a little bit here to get us to the next part here, which is, of course, I'm going to check for square to make sure that my cut was nice and square. And lo and behold, impressing myself here, it was. But with as square as it is, I want to make sure that it's as square as it possibly could be. So that's why we're going to the shooting board. Again, I'm going to go ahead and gang them up so that it makes quicker action out of, you know, one just big stroke here. So I'm going to do a couple of passes, and it went relatively quickly. Again, I just kind of sped it up for the sake of the video here. Unclamp it, and now all three pieces are pretty much ready to go. Now, I should mention that I already went ahead and shot the other end. Is it shot or shooted? No, it would be shot. The other end so that it's ready to go. And again, because I use the relative dimensioning, I'm going to get almost a perfect fit right from the very beginning. Now, I did leave them a little bit long just because I had other plans, but by a little bit long, I mean like maybe like 1/64th of an inch, so it's no big deal at all. Now, what I'm going to do is to attach them to the base, I'm going to use biscuits. So my first thing is I'm going to go ahead and use my tape measure here, and I think I laid them out so there was going to be a biscuit like every 3 or 4 inches. So I made a little mark there on the sides. I'm going to use the square to help make sure that I can definitely see them, because it's important when we get to the part where we use the biscuit cutter that you see where the marks are. Now, I'm going to transfer it to the mating piece. So I just take that piece, put it exactly where it needs to be, and I'm going to transfer those lines that I just made on the base to the face frame itself, so that when we go to cut the mating piece on the face frame itself, they'll line up exactly. So here, of course, is the biscuit cutter, and I have the face 90 degrees perfectly, well, as perfect as it's going to get, and it's important to push firmly so that it seats just the right way. I'm lining up the marks. You see those red marks there on the base plate? They're also on the front of it, and that's what I am lining up with the marks that you saw me make. Now, when it comes to the face frame, of course, like I said, we've transferred the marks to it, but what I want to do is I want the face frame to sit a little bit over the edge of the base. So that's what you saw me doing right now, was I was adjusting it so that the depth of cut is just a pinch off center. Not much, we're talking maybe a 32nd of an inch here, but I'll show you what the final result is, why I wanted to do that, because I'll be able to come back with a router and flush them up you know, exactly where I want them. But I will be seeing more about that in the very next episode. So I'm going to go ahead and finish making these cuts. And again, see how I'm ganging everything up. It gives me extra support there on the fence so that I don't have to worry about accidentally tipping the biscuit cutter as I'm making the cuts. And there's my perfectly routed or cut pieces. Now we'll take the one that you just saw me do. We'll go back over to the base, put the biscuits in, line it up, get it nice and flush. It lines up exactly where I want it, so the marks are perfectly aligned with each other. And here's what I'm talking about, just offset. Notice it's off just a little bit. I can just feel it. Now, for the horizontal pieces here, what I'm going to do again is relative dimensioning. And I've got my pieces, and you can kind of see me there. Which one am I going to use? Because really, these are almost offcuts. I'm using pieces that, since they're a little bit smaller, there's a little bit more sapwood in them. I've talked before about how I like to mix the sap and heartwood with it. But in this situation, I want to make sure I get the colors to line up. So that's what I was kind of playing with. I'll mark one end that I already have. I took over to the shooting board. Well, actually, I'm going to take it over to the shooting board right now. I know which end this is because of that mark. So when I go back over, I've got the grain going in the direction that I want, which is very important. Sometimes we'll go ahead and make cuts, but we'll forget what direction and what placement we want it. So you saw me do the shooting there, and we'll just go ahead and we'll double check it. Nice and square, exactly how we want it. We'll take it back over, put it into the position, and as you can see, there's the end result. Look how tight that is. That is a very nice, tight joint. But now, we want to repeat it on the other side. So, to do this, again, we're going to use relative dimensioning, and I raised it up just a little bit so that it's just catching the lip. And then, I'm going to take my pencil and make a mark on the opposite end, and this will be, you know, where I'm going to go ahead and take my square, and again, using the pencil, I'll make a mark so that I know where I want to cut. And then what I'll end up doing is, I,